Welcome to everyone, Salamta. I'm Alonzo and we come to you from Southern California. We'd like to give thanks to everyone that has supported this channel on YouTube, Rastafari Fellowship. And we would like to invite everyone that is interested in learning more to go to ethiopianworld.net on YouTube. And if ones are really considering Rastafari and are really interested in Rastafari, then we would highly recommend, we suggest that you log on to lojsociety.org/books. What that'll do, that'll take you directly to a large selection of very good books containing very necessary material, information that is much needed, and best of all, at affordable prices. Now, this presentation, this video message presentation, is concerning that name that no man knew but he himself. And so, just take note, fellow Rastafari, you know, pause the video and take these the reference to these verses down and, you know, go over them in time. And we're just gonna, you know, go to the verses, give a reference, and we're not gonna go into much of the details, but we hope that ones do. And so, you know, kind of we hope that this initiates some kind of study, you know, because I guess what we're trying to do here is not that we are instructors or anything like that, but ones really have to do their own work, because only when one as an individual studies to show himself approved, only in that way, only in that sense will one fully receive what it is possible to receive. And so let it, you know, enough talk. If ones would be kind enough, if ones are willing and able, open up your scripture to New Testament, direct yourselves over to chapter 19, verse 11. No, let's begin from verse 9. Just to make mention, verse 9 to verse 13 is pretty much a summary of Rastafari. And so let us go into it. And he said to me, write, blessed are they which are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true sayings of God. And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said to me, see thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. That being said, let us head on over to Johannes Wengel, the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shined in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Now let us go forward to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called the night. And evening and the morning were the first day. Now, you know, we're really tempted to go into much detail, but, you know, let us just try this. let us try to just present some good reference points so that ones as individuals in Rastafari can receive the Holy Spirit. You know, we can't stress how important it is to actually study, because until one actually does his own homework, it's then when that relationship begins to increase, and it is something special, you know. So we really recommend that ones do their best to study the material. Now let us begin with Book of Revelations. Let us direct I and thyself to chapter 1, verse 14. And we need make mention that these are really good reference points for the basics of Rastafari, you know. They are all in support of each other, and so they're all it all has to do with I and I as elect Rastafari. So, you know, it's go over these, and if ones are confronted with discussions or conversations, these are really good pointers to identify us as Rastafari. So, chapter 1, Book of Revelation, verse 14, and it reads, "His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like to the fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand 7 stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength." So let us direct thine ourselves over to Book of Genesis, chapter 2, verse 17. "He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit said to the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, the word of God, the name of God, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth." We do have to make this mention. So, chapter 19, it makes mention he had a name written that no man knew, but he himself means I and I too, means we are part of himself. In marriage, you know, the math is reduced to the least common denominator, and so in a marriage, in the covenant, in the union, in the tawahido, we are one, and so we take part in receiving that name. And here it's clearly proving in scripture that we too have received that name. And as a matter of fact, I mean, the word for himself in that case was it was autos, and meaning self operative, kind of like on its own, something that works on its own, but basically it has to do with again, and we're not going to go into the detail of again, but itself and distinguished a person, opposition and distinction. It's like not you only, a name that he himself knew, that no man knew but he himself, but not you only, but us too, is what it's trying to imply. It doesn't seem that way because of the false tongues of the Latin and Greek, but if ones look up the definitions and stuff like that, that is the reality of the message, of the so-called word he himself. Now, but he himself. Now, also interesting to mention that this is in the sense of a third person, and the word is aire or idol, like arrow or air, and you know, indicative of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the breath of life, and so on and so forth. But it's speaking to the air, speaking into the air, and speak what, and it is a type of speech that others hearing and listening cannot understand, cannot comprehend. Therefore it is symbolizing a higher speech, a speaking, a spiritual speaking. And so, you know, if one speaks spiritual things, the fleshy, even if it's not something complicated, but it is of a spiritual nature, the fleshy individuals will not understand at all. They'll have no idea what you're saying, even if it's a concept as simple as we are one. And so this is kind of how the Gnostic Gospels and John kind of testifies to this fact, that the testimony of a person in spirit, and of the in the spirit of Christ and truth, is very difficult for the fleshy and materialistic realm to understand. And for us that are spiritual, we recommend those spiritual speakings and speeches, because they are simple. They are really simple. It's like something that you can't explain, but you completely understand. Now, this is kind of how we take on conclude the covenant. So Father, Son, but the Holy Spirit needs a vessel to take on, and so we take on that spirit. And also, it's referring to a higher spirit and a higher air atmosphere and a lower atmosphere. The lower one is denser, and therefore we have the idea of the Prince of Darkness, the Prince Satan himself, being in the atmospheres and the airs, having powers in the itis, in the air, in the arrows, but in the lower firmament. And so then we have a higher, more rare air in the upper firmaments, in the higher realms, the heavens, we would say. So just to give ones an idea of we forgot what we were even speaking of, so it was chapter 2 of the book of Revelations, verse 17. So hidden manna, I guess the hidden manna would be an example of coming from the heaven as the dew, and it's kind of like him that cometh with clouds, and that I guess like the drops that when it's kind of like cloudy here in the lower atmosphere. And so it all falls into place. The manna, the word of the Almighty, and in this case the name that has been given to us to receive is the word of God. So it all ties in together. Now let us direct ourselves to chapter 6 of the book of Revelation, and head on over to verse 2. And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, a rainbow, and a crown was given to him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. The conquering lion of the tribe of Judah prevailed. So we know exactly what that's speaking of. So now let us go over to chapter 3, book of Revelations, verse 14. And to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things said the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. And so, the hidden one, the Amen, faithful and true witness, the begin. Let us just continue. Now let us spring on over to chapter 14 of the book of Revelation, and verse 14. And it reads, and I looked, and behold, a white cloud, and upon the cloud one sat like to the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. Now, a sharp sickle, I think that's kind of like referring to pointing. We mentioned this because it is necessary to understand that we are called to serve a purpose, and we are to record this. We are to be witnesses. We are to testify to events taking place prior to this flesh manifestation. Our call to making the word manifest in flesh is to testify to the things that were of old, and we bear witness. We must put forth our testimonies and declare that which is right. Name and written and called are really similar. It even implies calculating, so breaking down the word, rightfully dividing the word. It means setting up, to establish, to lay down it with your newlywed, so many different ways to connect, to bring together, to recall, to declare, to make mention. bring to memory. I mean, there's so many ways, but let us continue to establish the truth. We are to replace, to put in order, to number in sequence. So let us just continue. Okay, we were going to mention that sickle, pointing out to instruct, to teach, to tell. Yeah, he is God, the Most High God, Jah Rastafari. And also, kind of like that verse where it reads, and not one, although heaven and earth may pass away, but not one jot, not one tittle of my word will pass. Jot or tittle, one of those is referring to the 10th letter of the Hebraic alphabet. Or the more correctly, the Aleph Tau, but it is the Yod, and so it's funny because it's the Yoda or Yota in the Greek, and so one's familiar with the Yota software Amarena program, then it's interesting. But the strength of the Almighty, the hand, the Yod. So let us, it is because it's the smallest letter, and so not even the smallest detail will not pass of the word of the Almighty. And we see that in the faithful fulfillment of His Majesty, faithfully and truly fulfilling down to the very, very least detail. Now let us continue by directing ourselves over to Dan, the book of Daniel, and this is, we're heading on to the prophets, book of Daniel, chapter 7, and we shall go over chapter 7, verse 3, book of Daniel, chapter 7, verse 3, and it reads, okay, forgive me, it's verse 13, chapter 7, verse 13, I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory, and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. So I guess we have to add, Book of Revelations gives us a hint on what water signify, and it's implying peoples. It's meaning it gives us peoples, multitudes, tongues, and nations. So you know, do the math, calculate, and come to the eye's personal conclusion. Now let us direct ourselves to the book of the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 1, verse 26. And it reads, and above the firmament that was over their heads was the likeness of a throne, as the appearance of a sapphire stone, and upon the likeness of the throne was the likeness as the appearance of a man above upon it. So I guess this gives us evidence for the firmament, for that opinion or idea, or just putting it out there. Now let us go on forward to the prophet Isaiah, and we shall begin with chapter 62 of the book of Isaiah, the prophet, verse 2, and it reads, and the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all kings thy glory, and thou shalt be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord shall name. So that in itself is extremely important. Let us do verse 4, and it reads, thou shalt no more be termed forsaken, neither shall thy land and any more be termed desolate, but thou shalt be called Hephzibah. We think that has to do with Bathsheba. And thy land Beulah or Beth El, for the Lord delighteth in thee, and thy land shall be married. So once again, referring to the marriage, and even beyond that, it the new name, and you know, the not no longer being void and formless, So let us continue with chapter 63 of the book of Isaiah. If ones would just jump on over to chapter 63, and we shall begin with I guess let's start from verse 2. Wherefore art thou red in thy apparel, and thy garments like him that treadeth in the winefat? I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me. For I will thread them in mine anger, and trample them in my fury, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments, and I will stain all my raiment. For the day of vengeance is in mine heart, and the year of my redeemed is come. And I looked, and there was none to help, and I wondered, and there was none to uphold. Therefore my own arm, my own yod strength, brought salvation to me, and my fury, it upheld me. Now we do testify that in times of His Majesty makes mention. First, we turn to the Almighty Creator, the Almighty God, Creator of all that is good, and then we look deep within ourselves and in formless, in the void, and in a depression, kind of in the deep, you know, in tribulations, times of tribulations, when there is none to uphold thee, none to turn to, you look deep within yourself, and in a world born in sin, in all delusion and illusion, in vain imaginations and lies and slander and devilish, in a devilish realm, all is fake, all is nonsense, all is vain and empty. But if even in that moment of tribulation you seek deep within yourself, at least the pain that you are feeling, at least that will be kind of like the only truth that you've ever been confronted with, ever been given to receive, ever acknowledge and ever taken on. But at least that truth will lead you to emptiness. But then the emptiness within oneself, you hold on to thyself and you realize that you're holding on to everything. So it's the oneness, complete emptiness, in the same time complete holiness. And deep within I and thyselves, the temple where of the believers, or the those of pure heart, where the Almighty Creator dwelleth. And so therefore, by holding on to oneself, but looking deep within oneself, you realize that you're holding on to everything, and that is the Almighty Creator that has always been within I and I, dwelling within all this time, carrying us with wings like an eagle, like a bird. So I guess just throwing that out there. Let us continue to chapter 63, verse 12. Well, okay, let us do chapter 63, verse 12. And it reads, that led them by the right hand of Moses with his glorious arm, dividing the water before them, to make himself an everlasting name, dividing our troubles, separating us from this cruel and vain world, and even dividing the languages, the people, the nations, not in a William Lynch type deal, but rather in a separating the good from the bad, preparing for the day of harvest. Now, we forgot to make mention Isaiah chapter 62, verse 12, and it reads, and they shall be called, and they shall call them the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord. And thou shalt be called sought out, a city not forsaken. Sought out, we are to seek. That is extremely important. Many think that Geta Chucha shall come to our doors and kind of like, wake us up and hey, I'm Christ, I'm going to prove to you. That's vain imagination. It's not the case. We are to seek him. We are to look everywhere. So all those not knowledgeable in the truth of the revelation of Christ and his kingly character, behold the man, the life and character, faithful fulfillment of God the Father, the Word becoming flesh, his imperial majesty, Kedamawi Kaila Shalasi, elect of God, King of Kings, conquering line of the tribe of Judah, Emperor of Ethiopia. So now let us continue, go on forth to Book of Isaiah still, chapter 55, and we shall go over verse 6 And it reads, "Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near." You know, those that have ears, Shema, those that have eyes, behold his imperial majesty. Let us continue to chapter 60 of the book of Isaiah. Let us go to verse 3. And the Gentiles, chapter 60, the prophet Isaiah, verse 3. And the Gentiles shall come to the light, and the kings to the brightness of thy rising. Well, actually, before that, we do have to make mention. Let us do that over again. Chapter 60 of the prophet Isaiah, verse 1. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and the gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and the kings and the Gentiles shall come to thy... Oh, my bad. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and the kings to the brightness of thy rising. So we are in that time of darkness. Darkness, there has been a veil cast upon this earth. People are blind and manipulated. So we must testify and bring them to the remembrance of truth. We must establish the rightful authority upon this earth, because none shall do it for us. As a matter of fact, they do complete opposite. They wish to establish their vain imagination, and it is that which supports their falsology of legitimizing their superiority and their so-called wrongful rule upon earth. Now, let us direct thyself over to chapter 61. And this is verse 1. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. So this is exactly what Gita Jesus Christ said in the New Testament, in one of the Kidusan Wengil. Now let us go on forward to chapter 63. Oh, my bad, we read that already. Okay, let us go on forth to chapter 15, chapter 65, verse 15 of the book of Isaiah still. Isaiah the prophet, chapter 65, verse 15, and it reads, "And ye shall leave your name for a curse to my chosen, for the Lord God shall slay thee, and call his servants by another name." In this case, let us continue to verse 16. "That he who blessed himself in the earth shall bless himself in the God of truth. And he that sware in the earth shall swear by the God of truth, because the former troubles are forgotten, and because they are hid from thine eyes. And behold, for behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered, nor come into mind." So when it says here that "and you shall leave your name for a curse," it's not curse. This is King James and their attempt to manipulate the world and their misinterpretations. It actually is referring to oath, to seven, because back then oaths or promises were made, seven different sacrifices to establish that promise, that oath. But it has nothing to do with cursing in the sense of misfortune. So, you know, just King James and white supremacists at work. So we are to leave our name for an oath to his chosen. So now let us continue on to the book of Ruth. Well, that'll kind of lead us kind of far from where we're at. So let us first review Jeremiah, the book of Jeremiah, chapter 42. Prophet Jeremiah, chapter 42, verse 18, and it reads as follows: For thus said the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, as my anger and my fury have been poured forth upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so shall my fury be poured forth upon you, when ye shall enter into Egypt, and ye shall be an execration, and an astonishment, and a curse, and a reproach, and ye shall see this place no more. The Lord hath said concerning you, O ye remnant of Judah, go ye not into Egypt. Know certainly that I have admonished you this day. So let us continue on to just referencing Psalm 127 is it's a song of the Psalm of Degrees, but it is r related to this. We're not gonna review that, but keep in mind Psalm 127 is it relates. No, we let's go to that because let's go to that really quick because it is very necessary. Song of Degrees for Solomon. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchmen walk it, but in vain. We just got the idea that this is like our works without love are useless to the Almighty Creator. So unless the Lord get build it, it is in vain. It is in vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows. For so he giveth his beloved sleep, rest, and laying down the covenant, the marriage, the comfort of assurance that the ultimate good shall prevail. So now let us continue. Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. As arrows are in the hand of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. Happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with the enemies in the gate. So we shall speak, and we shall be those arrows impaling the wickedness of our enemies. And so, some shall willing by the will of the Almighty, they shall turn to the Almighty, but others shall be just destroyed. And we are to, we are to bring forth our fruit. And it is in fact our testimony. Now let us, okay, Ruth, almost missed it. Ruth chapter 4, the book of Ruth chapter 4, and we shall direct thine thyself over to verse 11. And all the people that were in the gate, and the elder said, We are witnesses. We too, Rastafari, must be witnesses. The Lord make the woman that is come into thine house like Rachel and Leah, which too did build the house of Israel. And do thou worthily in Ephratah, and be famous in Bethlehem. So yeah, we are to be witnesses. Now let us continue on to the book of Genesis. And well, let us go to the prophets really quick. We missed this. The book of Daniel's prophet Daniel, the book of the prophet Daniel, chapter 10, and we shall do a quick little reference to verse 6. So book of Daniel's prophets, chapter 10, verse 6, and it reads, His body also was like the beryl, and his face as the appearance of lightning. Now this is relating to Book of Revelations, chapter 1, verse 14, 16, 17, and so on. So, and like the strength of, and his countenance like the sun shineth in its strength. So it's giving us a description of a shiny bright dark or dark brown or black color, like fine brass burnt in a furnace. But let us continue. And his eyes as lamps of fire, and his arms and his feet like in color to polish brass, and the voice of his words like the voice of a multitude. So this is very, very important, because it gives reference not only to his feet being like fine brass burnt in the fire, but you know, doing away with any breathing space for the wicked. This too references his hands as also being of a polished brass. So now let us direct ourselves to we're missing some verses. We apologize for that, but we're just going to continue for now. Let us just continue. But so Genesis, hold on just 1 second, if you'd be so kind. Let us include in the book, in the prophet Isaiah, chapter 8, verse 16. Bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples. And I will wait upon the Lord that hideth his face from the house of Jacob. And I will look for him. Behold, I and the children whom the Lord hath given me are for signs and wonders in Israel from the Lord of hosts, which dwelleth in Mount Zion. So that is very, very important right there. And also, let us not forget Isaiah chapter 53, verse 1. Who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? You know, a report. Who has believed our report? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? So we are to put forth our reports. And now let us go to Genesis chapter 33, and it'll be verse 5. And it reads as follows. And he lifted up his eyes and saw the woman and the children, and said, Who are those with thee? And he said, The children which God hath graciously given thy servant. That is, in fact, I and I, as Rastafari. Now, Genesis chapter 15. And we shall go into verse 5. Genesis chapter 15, verse 5. And it reads, And he brought him forth abroad, and said, Look now towards heaven, and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said to him, So shall thy seed be. So now we always get stuck in this idea of numbering of multitudes, but I guess in a sense it's also implying, if you seek it out, like, look at the stars, at their glory, at the brightness, at the witness, at their testimony. If you could figure it out, if you could calculate it, if you could number it, you could put a name to it, if you could seek it out, so shall be the seed of Abraham. And so, you know, I mean, yes, it could be that this is referring to a large amount of individuals, but we are not totally convinced of that. I mean, it leads us to receive that it's making mention, you know, like the stars shine in their brightness, so we shall shine and reflect the glory of Yetzai Jesus, and automatically, inevitably, the Father shall be glorified himself in and through Yetzai Jesus. And so we are, you know, and we are a testimony, we are a witness. So if you could tell, like the stars, so shall we be, bringing forth our witness and testimony. And if they can number us, if they could name us and calculate and kind of like establish, okay, so Rastafari, it's the seed of Abraham, and therefore so shall we be, and then they would have received wisdom. and knowledge. So let us go over to Joshua, my bad, to the book of Joshua. And this is going to be chapter 24. And it seems like we're going to conclude there. We could go on forever, but you know, these are good reference points. We'll conclude here. Book of Joshua, chapter 24, verse 3 and verse 4. Well, let us begin with verse 2. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus saith the Lord, God of Israel, your father dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nachor, and they served other gods." Other side of the flood, Terah, it has to do with Faris and Persia and you know, the Syrian connection, where Abraham came from. But other side of the flood, we'll get into that. And I look, and I took your father Abraham from the other side of the flood and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his seed and gave him Isaac. And I gave to Isaac Jacob and Esau. And I gave Esau Mount Seir, or Sire, to possess it. But Jacob and his children went down into Egypt. So now, what we had in mind, and now we gotta study to show and ourselves approved, but to the other side of the flood. So is this, what is this inferring to? At first we had the idea that this is speaking of the Nile River and the yearly flood. Because, okay, we'll just put this out there, to conclude. We honestly, we expect that our studies will prove that most of this is taking place in Africa. So like the south would be mostly Africa and the so-called Arabia of nowadays, and then the north would be that little island, that little beach coast that people in their vain imagination pretend that it is the state of Israel. But so basically what I guess we got to put out, that the flood and all that just gives us the idea of the Nile overflowing and so going down into Egypt, and we know there's been a mix-up, and it's worse than we ever imagined. These people have been mixing up archaeological finds and truth, and they're destroying evidence, and they're mixing up names and locations. So we're, you know, the Jordan River, the nowadays Jordan River, you would expect there to be a lot of evidence, a lot of information, a lot of stories. It's really not that important at all. I mean, as far as I'm sure it's important, but there's no attention paid to it. It's like it does not glory in the way which they make it seem out to be. Like it doesn't make sense. The Nile River, on the other hand, is the most important river in the world. It's the largest. It is what all scholars and all white Europeans seek to study and to learn from and to have control of. And you know, we have a lot more evidence, for instance, like Araba, and champagne. The word champagne in the book of Genesis is referring to like the foaming, and it's referring to the foaming of the seas, of the waters, and the foaming is kind of like this, it gives the impression of the ocean, not just the sea, like the Mediterranean or the Red Sea, but the foaming, it's kind of like the huge currents and the waves and the foaming of the ocean. And Araba is a word that describes it, and it even kind of says something like a location near the Gulf of the Atlantic. And but we searched that out, and there's no such Gulf, but there is a so-called Atlantic Ocean. And further evidence to prove this is the word Araba itself. First of all, one could already make the connection to the Uruba, or the Araba peoples in the West, and that's exactly what Araba means. And then it further goes on to describe Arab, and it is implying, it is signifying setting down of the sun, the coming down of the sun, the West, the becoming dark. And it gives, and then it even says mixing kind of like a business type where one is responsible for the life of another. And so it even reflects the trading coast, the slave trade, and for example, Noah, when he sent out the that bird, he sent him out and in the sense of his life was responsible for Noah's, you know. He sent him out and he does this thing, and he's, instead of Noah having to go out there and risk his life, that bird was sent. And so, I mean, there's so many different ways to make that connection, but definitely Arab is not the East, because the sun does not set in the East, the so-called location, geographical location recognized as Arabia today, does not match the descriptions of the word Arab. And so it is something definitely necessary to look into. And in this case, where it says that Abram was to the other side of the floods, either it's not the floods of Noah, it doesn't appear to be that case, but it could be the flooding of the Nile. And then also Arabia, we've noticed that they change locations. They say that Arabia was more like where Jerusalem is today, at least in that areas, but then they pick and choose. So if they want to talk about the land of Sheba, then Arabia is in the south. But if they want to talk about Arabia something else, then no, it was in the north before. So they take and pick. I mean, they manipulate everything to their advantage, and we as Rastafari must do diligence to annihilate those such misinterpretations of vain imagination. So we're trying to find this really quick. And he sent forth a raven, which went forth to and fro. And so that is Noah sending out that bird. And you know, there's so much to this. So let us just conclude there. So we give thanks to everyone. Shalom, Rastafari.